Everyone, welcome to Journey Church. My name is Jen Berg, and I am the Journey Kids Director here. I have a couple of announcements for you. First, we will be offering some in-person and online Christmas Eve services. There are several options. You can come in-person at 3:30, in-person at 5, or in-person at midnight. And then we also have online at 5 o'clock as well. The midnight service will look a little bit different than the other two. It's a unique service, and we encourage you to wear your pajamas for that. So come join us at midnight or at one of the other two options. And then also, the weekend following that, the 27th and 28th, or 26th and 27th, we will be offering an online-only option. So it'll be Sunday at 10:30. You'll be able to view online, and that will also be an experience you don't want to miss because you will get to see all staff members in that video or in that service. And now, today we have a very special event for you. Behind me, I have some very brave Journey kids that are going to put on a show for you. Our show is called One Starry Night. And first up, we will, before they begin, I would like to recognize the directors that took on doing this for us. So we have Becky Gill, Chelsea Kipper, and Jen Martin. Can we give them a hand? They spent a lot of time and energy on this, so if you see them afterwards, just be sure to thank them. So first up, we have our preschool friends performing.
Flies. H is for Lily. R is for rejoice.
I is for Emmanuel.
S is for star.
T is for truth.
M is for Messiah.
S is for salvation.
Wasn't that just so precious? Thank you, preschool. You guys are all done. We're going to go over.
Thank you. Welcome to Journey Church. Today you'll get to hear the oldest and greatest story ever told, the story of Jesus' birth. It seemed to be just another normal starry night. That one starry night changed everything. We're going to take you on a journey from the shepherd's point of view of that first Christmas night. So sit back and relax and enjoy the program.
The city of Bethlehem was settling down for the night. They had no idea what was about to happen next.
The angels appeared in the sky, and the sleepy shepherds were surrounded by the brightness of God's glory. The shepherds were terrified.
The angel said, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all of the people.
Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord.
This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and laying in a manger."
The angel did. unto us a child is born, for unto us a son is given.
And the government shall be upon his shoulder.
And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor of the Mighty God, of Prince of Peace.
Quiet again, and the sky was filled with twinkling stars. The shepherds hurried into the town to find the baby Jesus.
They found Mary, Joseph, and the baby. The baby Jesus was sleeping in a manger in a humble cattle stall surrounded by animals.
The shepherds gazed into the eyes of the baby, their Savior, the one they had searched for. This was one amazing starry night.
Are you seeking Jesus like the shepherds did?
Thank you. The shepherds glorified and praised God for all the marvelous things they had seen and heard. Everything was exactly like as the angels told them.
After worshiping the baby Jesus, the shepherds were excited and began telling everyone about what had happened.
They wanted everybody to know about Jesus, the newborn king.
Just like the shepherds, we should tell everyone about Jesus Christ.
Yes, we should. Christmas is about God's love, hope, and peace that only comes from knowing him.
Go tell it everywhere.
Jesus is born!
Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 2. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him."
The journey had begun so many centuries before they had led the three wise men to here, to a little town, to a little house, to a little child, to the king God had promised David all those years before, Jesus' storybook Bible.
The wise men, or magi, were the first to seek out Jesus. It must have been a strange sight to see. Foreigners, strangers, people far from the Jewish way and world receiving a sign from God. In the sky, coming to worship a new type of king.
Matthew 2:11, verse 12. And going into the house, they saw a child with Mary and his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him.
Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh.
The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John chapter 1, verses 9 through 14.
This newborn baby is God's voice speaking into the world, saying, I see you, I am with you, and I love you more than you'll ever know. Pay close attention, because what I am about to do will open up the doors of the kingdom of God in the way that has never been opened before, and will make way for all that is wrong, and the world may be made right. Hope restored, life returned, love has come.
Today, we light the fourth candle of Advent as we celebrate the arrival of true love embodied in Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you that we live in a time such as today, Heavenly Father, where we get to know you, where we get to read your word, Heavenly Father, where we get to have an intimate relationship with you, and you know our worries and our cares. So, Lord, I just pray that as we hear this message today, Heavenly Father, that we, Lord, have the gifts and the fruits of your Spirit, Heavenly Father, that we have the fruits of Advent in our hearts, that we would have hope, that we would have peace, that we would have joy, and, Lord, most importantly, that we would have love. In your Son, Jesus Christ's name, everyone said.
Well, good morning and Merry Christmas. Really? Merry Christmas. Yeah. Hi, everyone online. Everyone say Merry Christmas to them so they feel a part of what's going on here. Your cue. That was even better. So that was really fun. I'm just wondering why y'all put your cameras away now that I'm standing up here. What's up with that? If you had them back there, Alex and I really had the moves going, so you missed out by watching the kids. But I understand. I have like cramps in my face from permagranning the whole time. That's one of my favorite parts of Christmas. Is it yours? It really is. The cuteness, talking about Jesus, it's great. So there's a few other things. So I want you to raise your hand if this is your Christmas favorite, one of on your top list. So Christmas lights. So the rest of you don't have Christmas trees and stuff. All right, let's keep going. Christmas parties, the Christian-y kind of parties, because we're in church after all. Now be careful about not raising your hand with this next one because of who might be sitting next to you, but family get-togethers? Yeah, those are the favorite for sure. There's two more. for me on my list that I'm going to share with you. I know sometimes I have this reputation here in our church that I'm the vulnerable pastor, the one who shares his stories that make you all feel awkward. So I'm going to do that first off so that you can get over the awkwardness as we get to the scripture. I'm pretty confident that when I share two more things on my Christmas favorites list, that I'm going to lose my man card in some of your eyes. So the best way to describe it, by the way, I'm rocking the Christmas beard, so I'm confident in my masculinity. We're taking a vote as to when I should shave, but the president of my house will have veto power when that happens. But I don't care what you think about what I'm about to share with you, because I'm confident. God made me this way. So here we are. Here's a plaque that's in our kitchen. I just want to bake stuff and watch Christmas movies. So that is my wife's plaque. Her friend gave it to her. But those are the two things that I have to add to my favorite things at Christmas. I just want to bake stuff and watch Christmas movies. Tina doesn't. I'm the chef and the cook in our house. She cleans up after me because I am not a neat person when it comes to that. But I really love that stuff. So I think we should alter this. I told Tina, she saw it last night, to this. We need to add this. I just want to watch my husband bake stuff and watch Christmas movies, because that's how it works in our house. It works. It's just a good balance. Now, I know I'm not really ashamed of the baking thing, because chefing is something that a lot of dudes do. A lot of men are chefs, so I'm not that ashamed of that. But the second part, the watching Christmas movies. Now, I know I shared this last year, that Hallmark movies and me have a close relationship. I watch them even without my wife sometimes, and some of you men felt comfortable enough in your relationship with me and your own masculinity that you came and confessed that weirdness to me as well. So we have a private club that membership is kept very secret, but that's kind of my thing. I love Christmas movies and baking so much that last Friday, true story, I had scheduled to go to lunch with a guy that I go mountain biking with that's in another Bible study that I get to lead on Tuesday nights, not a journey group. And we hadn't spent any time together, and I wanted to hear his story more and tell my story. So we scheduled lunch on last Friday to go to a very manly place, Smash Burger. I mean, that's a pretty manly lunch place. And guess what I did to my friend? I forgot. Because I'm not making this up. I was baking French macarons and watching a Christmas movie. I stood up a man, a friend, because I was doing that very masculine thing there. I woke up in the middle of the night, Friday night, and went, oh, man, that's when I remembered, and I got a hold of him, and he forgave me, because he's a brother in Christ, so he's overlooking that. We'll still get together one of these days. I just love Hallmark movies. Even some of you were teasing me this morning. You act that's true? It's true. I love them. I watch them with Tina and without Tina. We watched one this morning. We got up a little early and watched one together so I could get all primed up. Those movies are pretty predictable, aren't they? Pretty predictable, pretty cheesy. I'm going to give you the rundown. If you haven't seen them, which I'm sure you have, you just don't want to confess, especially you in the front row. It always starts off with someone that's usually like a PR executive or a newscaster. That's usually the main person who's in the big city, some other big city that has to travel for some reason to Podunk America, Christmasville. There's usually Christmas in the name. This morning there was. And then these two unlikely people just run into each other, the PR executive or the person that's the news reporter, and they run into Podunkville person, and they don't really like each other, but they sort of like each other, if you get my drift. They get the vibe, they think each other's attractive, all that. And as you go through the movie, to the delight of the whole community, they fall in love, while the big city person falls out of love with a relationship that really wasn't all that healthy. Usually there's a car accident involved or some weather incident with their car. And of course, because of inclement weather, they can't get the part in, because it is Podunk Christmasville, America. They just can't get parts in a day. So they're stranded there, which gives them time to develop this relationship of love for each other. Then there's also the acting. We were talking about this morning. I keep waiting for Hallmark acting calls to come here to Peoria, because I was a thespian in high school. I think I can act as good as the cameraman's daughter or the cameraman's niece or whoever's in those shows, but it's okay. It's okay. Oh, by the way, I forgot one. Newscaster, PR executive, what else is in those? A prince or a king who falls in love with a very ordinary person. Not usually a princess. It's usually the other way around. All that predictability. I recommend you watch them. I still haven't seen one, even though I can predict it, that I love to watch. Why are those so popular? This is my theory. I think that we love Christmas movies, Hallmark movies particularly, because in those movies, it's the story of redemption. I really think that that's why we like them so much. Redeemed attitudes, redeemed relationships, redeemed life, redeemed love. People in Hallmark movies, they're trying to get redeemed from loneliness, from relationships that have gone bad, from love that's never deep enough. Really, not just redemption, I think Hallmark movies are about salvation. Not necessarily about salvation from Jesus, but about being saved from things that have overtaken a person's life. And we're going to talk today about that, about salvation, not just of circumstances, but the salvation of your soul. Salvation, being saved from things, when we have this gnawing that we know that it's better than this, that there's something better than this, it's a human desire to seek out salvation. So people like Hallmark movies because they like salvation. It's really that simple to me. We love those movies because it gives us hope. We just got to take it farther and have hope in the right things, from soulful things, from things about eternity, things that matter for eternity. And I'm here to tell you that I think Jesus would like it that I like Hallmark movies, because I like salvation, because I like redemption. That's what Christmas is about. It's kind of the ultimate redemption message from God, the ultimate message of love, about salvation, not just of your situation and not just of your eternity, but both of those together, your Christmas time right now and what you're going to do when you go from here, and Christmas time next year, and also for eternity. So even if it's the unseen things, the things that you won't confess, so even if it is the Hallmark movie watching, Christmas cookie baking, standing your friend up at Smashburger guy that you don't want anyone else to know about, Jesus came to even work on those things. There's nothing more than God wants than for your life to be redeemed, to be restored to what he wants it to be, not just in eternity, but now. And that's what we've been talking about as we go into Advent this year. So we're on the last one. The last candle that we're going to light on Thursday is the Jesus candle as we celebrate his arrival. Today we're talking about love, or the ultimate Hallmark movie of your life, the love that God has for you, for your soul, and for your life. God's quest is to bring you into the best relationship with him and the best life with him now, not just in eternity. And that comes through who we just got done singing with the kids about, Jesus Christ. Love is one of the biggest themes of Christmas. Love is not a human idea, by the way. Love is God's idea. God's the originator of love. In 1 John, in one chapter, chapter 4, two times it says this, God is love. It doesn't say God loves love. It doesn't say God thinks love is a good idea. Love makes the world go around and you should always write songs about love. He describes himself as love. Christmas is the culmination of God's expression of love for us. There's others, but that's definitely the focus of Christmas, the culmination of his quest for love, to let us know how much he loves us. The world has some ideas about love. I've been asking around this last week about what do you think how would the world define love? And people have come up with a word more than any other word. Any guesses as to what that word would be? Feeling. It's a feeling. In fact, if you looked it up, that's probably the definition you would look. This intense, warm, fuzzy feelings of love inspired by this cocktail of stuff in your brain that just makes you feel all warm and fuzzy. But if love is based on feelings, what happens when that brain cocktail dissipates? When the feelings change, then love changes. Love can fade if it's dependent on feelings. What I've loved about this series, if we've been going through it, is that each of these Advent words, we've been looking at it from a worldly point of view, the definition of what the world would describe it as, and what the Bible would describe them as. And we've seen that the Bible's definition of these words is much deeper and much wider and much more life-changing than the world's, and love is the same way. So I put down some things here, that when the Bible talks about love, this is how it categorizes it. Biblical love is others-oriented, almost always. Biblical love is given away for a better future. Two important parts. It's given away for a better future. Biblical love feeds the soul in the moment and in eternity, both now and then. There's four words in the Bible to describe love. We're not going to go over those four words, but I can tell you all four of those words are all about giving it away, not receiving it, and not about warm, fuzzy, brain-influenced feelings that we get from being loved. The Bible is seldom about feelings. It can be a little project for you. You can go online and look up all the verses for love this next couple of weeks and go through them and see how many times it has to deal with feelings versus giving love away to bring you closer to God now and for eternity. So, therefore, this is where I've gotten to. Biblical love has two important components: commitment and vision. Both of those important commitment parts of love, commitment and vision in the Bible, not feelings. Commitment and vision. So I came up with a definition. This is what we're going to talk about today. Biblical love is a commitment of vision from a person to a person, a person to a person, and a person to a person. And that's not redundant. You see the little nuances in the capitalization there? So first, it's from capital P, which is God, our Heavenly Father. That's where love comes from, to us, little p, from a person to a person, back to God, from us back to God, and then from a person to a person, from us to each other. So that's going to be what we're looking at today. I think my biblical definition that I gave you will show you this, and we're going to look at three people in the Bible. We're going to look at God the Father, we're going to look at Mary, and we're going to look at Joseph in the Christmas story and look at those. So the first one, big P to little p, God our Father to you, the big guy, the guy himself, the originator of love. Most famous verse in the Bible, I talked about it a couple weeks ago. Any takers? What verse is that? Everyone knows it. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall have eternal life, shall never perish. God so loved everyone. God so loved me, even though I love to bake cookies and watch Christmas movies. He loved me. God so loved you that he didn't come for you, he came to you. That's what God did. He was the originator of that. He moved first toward you. The first half of the verse says, for God so loved the world that he gave. It's that definition. It's always outward focused. God's love for you is so intense, is so committed, and so visionary. He wanted what he wanted for you, what he designed you to be a part of, that he came to you. There's this great paraphrase that I like from a guy named Eugene Peterson, who wrote the Message paraphrase or translation of the Bible. He's a linguist, so he took the languages that it was originally written in and tried to put it in language that we would conversate about. And this is how he says about God. For God so loved the world that he moved into the neighborhood. He didn't say, hey, you move to my neighborhood, or even you go to a particular church, which you should do anyway. I'm not saying don't do that. But he said, I'll come to you on your turf. I'll come to you where you are rather than you coming to me. So a couple of weeks ago, I got this moment with a friend of mine that was the most poignant moment of Christmases for many, many years. I said last night, it's going to take me in the positive way years to get over this moment. So David Comstock, our family teaching pastor, and I do a podcast that we release on Wednesdays. I'm telling you, you need to do it. It's really, really good because we're really, really smart and stuff, and it just totally enrich your life. So you should check it out because we just have conversations about what the lesson was on Sunday. And so we were talking about joy. And I made the comment at the end of that message that week that joy is really a human thing. It's like what one of our image-bearing things from God, because my dogs, other than when we feed them and play with them, they really don't have that much joy. It's just based on their needs, not based on something deeper than that. And so David said this thing to me. He said, do you love your dogs? And I said, oh, yeah. I'm kind of a weird dog person. I mean, I let them lick my face and all that kind of weird stuff. So I'm kind of a weird dog person. I said, yes, I love my dogs. And David said, do you love your dogs enough to become a dog? And I said, no. I didn't have to think much about that. I like this. I like being human. I like being an image bearer of God. My dogs are great, but they're not human. I like being human. And David said to me, the profound moment, God became a dog. And he's not calling God a dog. Don't get all about that. What he's trying to say is God came into my neighborhood. He came into what I was. I love my dogs, but I'm not going to become one to convince them of how much I love them. Do you get what I'm getting at? That's what God did. God loved me enough to become human as God's son, Jesus. He loved me enough to engage me for a better present and for a better future. And that's huge. That's big. For God so loved you that he came to you. That's the first concept of love we want to grab onto today. That's kind of the big one. But we're going to talk about two human stories now of Mary and from Joseph about people and how their story intersected with God. Because Joseph and Mary are you. Joseph and Mary are me. So we're going to look at how they responded to God and then how we can start to carry on. So we're going to look at Mary, the mother of Jesus, before she became the mother of Jesus. I want to remind you of the definition. Biblical love is a commitment of vision from a person, little p, to a person, big p. And I'm going to read from Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to the city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin, betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. She was getting ready to marry into the family. And the virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be since I'm a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, and therefore the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, our relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was previously called barren, for nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Let it be to me according to your word. How great and how loving a response is that for Mary? Well, that's where she got to, but did you see where she started even in that encounter? In verse 29, it says she was greatly troubled just by the greeting, just by some angelic being showing up in your house, in your bedroom, and saying, "Hey, you're favored by God. Uh-oh, what's the string attached?" She was troubled, but by the end of it, a loving response back to the originator of love. She responds back. Now, Mary, it says that she had gained favor with God. So she was probably a pretty dedicated follower of God. She probably understood stuff about God. She was probably an exemplary member of her community. She was probably an exemplary member of God's kingdom. One that was already there and one that was about to come. The one that she was a part of to bring you salvation. Your ultimate Hallmark movie, that God was going to restore your soul into union with him. She probably knew about the biblical prophecies. She probably knew how the prophecy said this Messiah, the Savior of her and the Savior of you, would come about through a virgin birth. In Isaiah 7, 13 and 14, she probably knew this passage. And he said to her, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary men that you weary God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." So she knew, most likely knew how this was going to take place, that it would be kind of special, kind of spectacular, kind of miraculous. But I bet she never thought it was going to be her, that God was going to use her directly in the big part of his plan. She gets up one morning, just a regular Nazarite girl, doing her thing, and she gets visited by an angel of the Lord who tells her that she's highly favored and she's going to be a big part of the plan, God's plan. She goes to bed that night, intricately involved in the consummation of God's plan for your salvation. Have you ever been a part of something happened to you, and you just kind of say, "Why me?" I wonder if Mary did that even after she said, "Yeah, may it be according to your word," as she submitted her love back to God. Have you ever answered that question when it's you, "Why me?" Have you ever answered, "Why not me?" I bet that's where Mary got to that morning. Why not me? You know, one of the biggest ways God uses to move forward his plan then and today is through you, through people That's who God uses. He uses people to further his plan. Why me, God? Instead, we could say, why not me, God? Is this what you created me to be a part of? So when we have that first question, when God's calling us into his big plan in our life, what we're a part of, we should answer the question with a question, why not me? So this last person we're going to look at is Joseph, the earthly father of Jesus. So we're moving to the next part of the person to a person. Biblical love is a commitment of vision from a person to a person, from one of us to one of us. So let me read Joseph's encounter from Matthew chapter 1. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, as she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. That's you. That's me. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. So just like Mary, Joseph was, it appears, an upstanding citizen of his community as well. And it appears that he was an upstanding citizen of God's kingdom as well. He was a good guy in the clan and a good guy in God's plan. And just like Mary and just like the angel recounted, he most likely knew of how this Messiah, the Savior of humankind's soul, their souls would come about through a virgin birth. But him? This was pretty exceptional. It was exceptionally messy. Could you imagine, Joseph? This is a little messy. I love her, but this is just kind of messy. This is complicated. This could really change things up a little bit for him and for Mary. So he knew what would come of Mary. You know what would have come of Mary if you know anything about the Old Testament. Besides chastisement and humiliation, it would likely mean death, because when you were betrothed in that culture, it was all but married. The last step was to have a ceremony and then to be together and to live together. Everything else had taken place. It was a commitment of love between them, and he was going to get a divorce even before they were married. A little harder for us to understand, but that's what was going on here. So from a cultural point of view, he would have been justified, but he was trying to be noble. Did you see the love that he had for Mary in this? Carefully, quietly, privately, he contemplated his next move because he loved her. And then an angel of the Lord came to him and told him what to do, and he loved God and put himself a part of the vision that God had for Mary, and part of the vision that God had for him, that he was going to be an active participant in the bringing together of this Messiah as his earthly father, the larger story of the Messiah coming to earth for us. I wonder if he responded similar to Mary at first. Why me? And then he gets this angel message. Why this? This way? Why involve me in this? Do you ever do that? Even with someone that you're partnered with in life and God has a calling on their life, you're going, this is weird. This is messy. It's not convenient. I have this carefully constructed life with these great boundaries. I have great boundaries, and this steps outside my boundaries, my managed, well-conceived, and convenient plan for my life. Why me? Same answer. Why not me? Why this way? Why not this way? God's up to stuff. See, God, Mary, Joseph, all here in this story, acting in love toward each other outwardly to bring about God's glorious plans, which involved you today in this life. God, Mary, Joseph, Carlisle. Makes me a little uncomfortable. All acting in love to bring about God's glorious plans today. Not just in eternity, but today. God, Mary, Joseph, you. Coming together in love to bring about God's glorious plans in the middle of COVID Christmas 2020. That's a big story. That's a cool thing to be a part of. See, biblical love imitates its source, capital S, by responding back to the source. God's love, we respond back to God's love, and then we pay it forward back to God, join him in his plan for us, and we pay it forward with each other. So how would you define love today? Now that we've spent some time talking about love, how would you define love? What are some of the components of love? Is the world's view different from the biblical view? Yes. Have I convinced you yet? Yes. God's view of love is different from the world's view of love. Would you agree? Please say yes. Please believe yes. Is the Christmas story's view of love different from the world's view of Christmas? Yeah, it is. Loving biblically means that we serve God and we serve people to move us today toward God's best intentions for our life today and in eternity. It's a commitment, a vision, God's vision for each other, for ourselves, and for what he's doing. So this Christmas, is your Christmas inspired by movies and baking? Obviously, my answer is yes, and that's okay to a certain level. Is it inspired by family time together? Is it inspired by Christmas carols, unless you're Alex McBride? He really does like Christmas carols. We just like to tease him about that. Wait, maybe he doesn't. Moving on, Christmas lights. What attachments do you have toward Christmas? Those are wonderful things that bring us into the warm fuzzies of Christmas. But those things should remind us of something much bigger, a few things that are much bigger. Those things should remind us of God's love for us, our love back toward God, and our love toward each other. So I have these three questions for you. For God so loved the world, person, big P, to a person. Biblical love is a commitment, a vision from God to you. God loves you. Receive that. Accept that this year. As you get closer and closer to Christmas, ponder this question. How has God shown his commitment to you and given you a vision from him? Grab onto it. Move forward with it. Mary said, may it be as you have said. Biblical love is a commitment, a vision of God to you and from you back to God. Mary loved God, and she showed it. How do you show your love toward God even this Christmas? You have a commitment, a vision back to God and what God's up to in your life, in your circle of friends, in your circle of family, in your neighborhood. God will do it his way, and he invites you to join him in what he's doing. Joseph did what the angel told him to do and took Mary as his wife. He loved Mary, and he loved God, and he committed himself back to both of them. How are you committed to God's visions for someone else that might be sitting right next to you? Are you committed to the vision God has for them? Those are the thoughts I want to leave you with. We're going to have one last Advent prayer, and then I'll come back up and share a closing thought.
You all bow your head and pray with me. Dear Lord, thank you for sending your son Jesus to bring hope, peace, joy, and love into this world, and help us to live at Advent, and help us as long for his return, and may each person leave this place today with candles of Advent burning bright in their heart. Amen.
As you go today, be thinking about Advent, be thinking about love, God's invitation for you to go, even right now, today, that you can be a part of God's plan for humanity, people that are in your life. So be pondering that this week. Come back Thursday. We have our two afternoon services and our midnight mass, which is going to be super cool, not just because I can't wait to see you in your pajamas, but because we're going to take communion together and really have an experience. So invite your friends and neighbors, and we'll see you on Thursday. Merry Christmas, and go in God's love. Be blessed.